Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present Netforce, Attack Protocol, a novel. Series created by Tom Clancy and Steve Pieczenik. Written by Jerome Preisler. Performed by Seth Podowitz. All warfare is based on deception. Hence, when able to attack, we must seem unable. When using our forces, we must seem inactive. When we are near, we must make the enemy believe we are far away. When far away, we must make him believe we are near. Sun Tzu, The Art of War. Part 1. War Driving, November 22nd to 23rd, 2023. 1. Satu Mare District, Romania. The first snowfall of the season was dusting the banks of the Samish River when a catastrophic failure struck the power grid, plunging the western third of the country into darkness. Niku Burgos was just an hour into his midnight shift when things went wrong. An operator for Satu Mare District's Electrica Power Distribution Center, he was tired from caring for his daughter, who was 7 and sick with the flu. His wife, Balia, a sales clerk at a clothing store, was also miserably under the weather, and he had been doing his best to help her as well. But money was tight, and like him, Balia needed to work and bring in a paycheck. The night before, she had come home from the shop, put chest rub on Angela, tucked her in, showered, and climbed into bed with her dinner untouched. Niku normally slept until 9 p.m. or even a little later, but the sounds Angela was making in her room concerned him. He had lost his dear mother to the pandemic 3 years ago, and the outbreaks still could be vicious. Taking no chances, he'd resolved to stay up to check on the child, poking his head through the doorway every 15 or 20 minutes. It was a while before she settled in. So Niku was worn out and bleary, which might have been why he doubted his eyes when he saw the cursor suddenly drifting across his screen. The computer was networked into the energy grid, and the numbered blue buttons on its display controlled the circuit breakers for 10 substations throughout the country, an area of almost 1,700 square miles with some 300,000 residents. The cursor landed on the switch for substation 1, clicked. A dialogue window opened below the button. Warning, opening the breaker will result in complete shutdown. Do you wish to proceed? Yes? No. Reaching for his mouse, Niku tried to drag the cursor out of the window, thinking its driver might have developed a minor glitch. But it remained there, and slid to yes. He quickly swiped the mouse across its pad, wanting to move the cursor to no. It stayed on yes. Clicked. The dialog box vanished and the button for substation 1 changed from blue to red. Niku inhaled. He had been an operator at the distribution center for half a decade and did not need to bring up a map to see the region each substation covered. The map was already in his head. Substation 1 was Lazuli, a rural commune of 6 villages to the extreme north near the Ukrainian and Hungarian borders. Its 6,000 residents had now gone offline. Even as Niku registered this, the on-screen cursor jumped to the Substation 2 button. He snatched up the mouse in desperation, lifting it above the pad. It made no difference. The cursor clicked, opened another dialog window requesting confirmation, went to yes again. Click. Blue turned to red, and Niku Burgos watched Substation 2 go down in an instant.
Draga meo Donizeo, he rasped. My dear God.
Substation 2 was the city of Satu Mare itself. With a population of 100,000, a full third of the county's inhabitants, it was now completely dark. Niku tried to think clearly. During the day, the operating station would have 2 people on shift. There was a second computer to his left with a separate monitor. Possibly the problem was only with his machine. If he could log into the system using the other computer, he might prevent more breakers from tripping open. He rolled his chair in front of it, tapped the keyboard. The computer came out of idle, showing the operator login screen. He entered his username and password. A wrong password notification flashed on screen. He slowly retyped the password, thinking he might have entered a wrong character in his haste. The notification appeared again. He was locked out of the system. Niku sat up straight, his spine a stiff rod of tension. His original machine showed that Substation 3, which provided power to Negrestioas's 12,000 citizens, was down. He glanced at its screen just in time to see the cursor move to Substation 4, the distribution station for the commune Mediesu Auritz's 7 villages. The two stations combined served more than 20,000 customers. He remembered that tonight's temperature was forecast to drop below freezing in the mountain areas and felt suddenly helpless. Whatever was causing the shutdowns, he could not deal with the growing emergency himself. His heart pounding, he reached for the hotline to call his supervisor. The Black Bearcat G3 bore north on the unmarked strip of macadam that linked Satumare City to the tiny farming village of Rosalvia in the Carpathian foothills. Its windshield wipers beating off fat, wet flutters of snow, the vehicle moved smoothly and quietly for a big four-tonner armored with hardened ballistic steel panels. At the wheel was Scott Dixon of the CIA's elite manhunting Fox team, recently placed under operational detachment to Net Force. Kali Alcazar sat beside him. In her late 20s, she had short, silver-white hair and wore a black stealth suit and lightweight plate vest. They were standard organizational issue. A Victorian English adventurer's belt and a vintage film canister pendant hanging from her neck were personal additions.
"How we doing time-wise?" Dixon asked.
Kali looked at her dash screen. On it was the same controller's interface Niku Burgos was struggling with at the power distribution center. A moment ago, she had seen the circuits trip in rapid succession. "Pickles," she said, using the unfortunate name given to the vehicle's AI by its architect, Sergeant Julio Fernandez. "Yes, Kay?"
"Outlier," she corrected, using the dark web handle she had long ago created for herself.
"Yes, Kay."
"Bring up the Satumare power grid."
"Yes, Kay."
She clicked her tongue. Fernandez had infused the AI with one too many of his stubbornly aggravating personality traits. But the upside was that, like Julio, it was also smart, nuanced, and intuitive. She could live with it. In front of her now, the panel on screen was replaced by a sector-by-sector map of the region, its cities and towns numbered according to the substations that supplied their electricity. The 5 already offline were black, the rest red. She watched as a 6th went dark.
"Over half the stations are down," she said. "Total blackout in about 5 minutes.
"Bitter cold out, 250,000 people without light or heat," Dixon said. "Women, children, seniors, all for the sake of bagging one guy."
She glanced over at him.
"The hackers, the Tecnologia Vampiri, are the local economy. The government protects them, the polizei, the citizens, everyone."
He shrugged with his hands on the wheel. She was right. Suspicions definitely would have been raised at the syndicate's current headquarters, the Wolf's Lair, if they only cut power to its surrounding village.
"I get it," he said. "Still tough."
"Tougher than it was on New York?"
Dixon didn't answer. 4 months ago, the Vampiri had launched a cyber attack that left the East Coast a shambles, killed hundreds, and almost took out the president. Now, his team's pursuit of the wolf had led them out here to the Romanian boonies, making them key players in the first fully integrated operation conducted by the various elements of America's new Department of Internet Security and Law Enforcement, NetForce in bureaucratic government shorthand. He really did get it. The Bearcat rolled between the gigantic evergreens standing sentinel on either side of the road. In the rear compartment, Greg Long, Fox Team, sat with a small detachment on loan from Task Force Quickdraw. 6 men in tactical gear with Mark 18 CQBR carbines strapped over their shoulders and short-barreled Mossberg 590 combat shotguns racked to the sides of the passenger compartment.
"Distance to the target?"
Dixon asked after a few minutes. This time, Kali skipped the AI, tapping her computer keyboard for the GPS sat map.
32 miles.
Dixon nodded and checked the speedometer. He was doing about 50, so a little over half an hour.
Taking his hand off the wheel, he adjusted his earpiece and hailed Carmody on the ground to air. Raven winged over the Romanian countryside at her top cruising speed of 280 knots, her tilt rotors angled down for forward flight. She had maintained an altitude of 6,000 feet, slightly below the low, heavy ceiling of clouds. Faye Luna and Ron Cobb, Net Force Psi-I Surveillance and Aviation, occupied the pilot and co-pilot seats. Mike Carmody, Fox Team, stood behind them in the cockpit's dimness, facing its wide wraparound window, peering down through the gauzy veil of snow. One after another, the rows of homes on the streets and lanes below went dark. He thought suddenly of Christmas lights, strings of unplugged Christmas lights.
Preacher, you copy?
It was Dixon over the Radio Over Internet Protocol, or ROIP. He was using Carmody's call name for the mission.
Yes, he said. His hands were meshed together behind his back. What's up?
The precip's heavier than expected, Dixon said. Want to confirm you're still tracking us?
Carmody moved up to the touchscreen interface spanning the width of the avionics board. It was, as his training instructor put it, a giant smart tablet. Pinch, zoom, swipe. External sensors on the outside of the aircraft, its PDAS, or Pilotage Distributed Aperture Sensor Suite, gave the multifunction display a fully integrated 360-degree view of Earth and sky. Set for night flying, the screen's background was a fused infrared low-light magnification terrain map of Satumare. Its radiance washed the cockpit in green and gray. Raven was a bespoke version of the Bell V-280, and Carmody saw her as tricked out like something straight from a sci-fi flick. At a cost of $50 million, she was expensive but worth it. He'd proposed that NetForce order 20. Its director of operations, Carol Morse, requisitioned a fleet of 10. Congress had approved funding for two. He selected a tracking window for the two Bearcats and widened it with his thumb and forefinger. The SUVs appeared inside it, along with the GPS latitude, longitude, altitude, and speed coordinates.
Rover 1, I see you fine, he said.
Nice being the only things with lights.
Carmody wished he could have lit a cigarette.
Okay, keep it rolling.
He signed off and glanced over at Luna. Dark-haired, round-faced, she looked about 15, but he knew her qualms and reputation as an ace among flying aces, U.S. Air Cavalry, Task Force Viper, Afghanistan. Then college on the GI Bill and a stint with the FBI Critical Incident Response Group. She and Cobb had crewed the only chopper allowed in the air over New York in the hours after the attack, their actions earning the express gratitude of POTUS herself.
Better run my checks, he said.
Yes, sir.
She kept her right hand on the joystick, pointed to the screen with her left.
The birds picked up quite a tailwind. We could beat our own ETA.
The aircraft rocked and trembled on an air pocket. Carmody turned toward the cockpit door, grasped the handle. He thought about Drajan Petrovic, the wolf, and their first encounter in a dark Bucharest hallway, about squeezing his wounded arm and feeling his blood well up between his knuckles. Carmody had smelled the hacker's blood in a corridor splashed with the blood of dead men and thought he could smell it now, tasted at the back of his tongue like copper. But that was his imagination. He paused and breathed through his nostrils as if to prove it to himself. Nothing. Just the sterile, filtered scentlessness of the recycling cockpit air. After a moment, he pushed through the door and joined his men in the troop cabin. 2. Băneasa, Romania, FOB Janus. 450 miles southeast of Satumare, the Midnight Runners were gathering for their nightly meetup. Organized by physician Levon Hughes at Forward Operating Base Janus, the group had grown from Levon and her two staff nurses to about a dozen regulars. Tonight, they were short a few members, several of them on assignment with the Satumare hunting expedition. As she did her warm-ups near the south perimeter fence, Levon saw three late arrivals hurrying over from their barracks. She straightened from a calf stretch and waved, steam puffing from her mouth into the cold, snow-flecked air.
With almost a third of its personnel upcountry and only a thin detail left behind, the general mood around the installation was anxious. Scalpel was FOB Janus's first official operation since its transfer from U.S. Army Command to Net Force Quick Draw. It was dangerous and politically sensitive. Levon wasn't sure how much the Romanians knew about it, but she'd heard through the grapevine that it wasn't half what they were supposed to know. Meaning that if the task force ran into trouble, they could face major consequences from their host government in addition to whatever the hackers threw at them. And the technology of Ampiri weren't your stereotypical keystrokers. They were violent criminals, armed to the teeth, and ready for a fight. The latecomers reached Levon and the others at the fence. Sergeant Pierce and Privates Ryder and Barrow were all on Colonel Howard's staff and had just completed their shift.
Evening, she said to Pierce. How's it going in command?
The colonel's been stuffing his pipe with tobacco all night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.